Tomorrow, 4:30 a.m., is actually an important anniversary because we will be recognizing the 150th anniversary of the Civil War, firing on a United States military installation by Confederate batteries in Charleston Harbor, the opening salvo of the Civil War. We still have a long ways to go in terms of changing perceptions and bridging gaps, of generating interest in the war and seeing the war in a much broader way. And the next speaker we have today is someone who is working very, very hard to do that. Hermina Glass-Avery is Associate Director of the Center for the Study of the Civil War at Kennesaw State University. She is a wonderful historian, and there's a much longer biography of her in here, but I think one of the most important things that she is doing right now is helping to bring African Americans and the Civil War together to promote an understanding of the Civil War among African Americans, and we're delighted that she is here today to be one of our speakers. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Hermina Glass-Avery.
Afternoon. I bring you greetings from the Center for the Study of the Civil War Era at Kennesaw State University, where we just facilitated about 2 weeks ago the 8th annual symposium on new interpretations of the Civil War. In collaboration with the National Park Service and Kennesaw Mountain National Battlefield Park, we are engaged with connecting the consequences of the Civil War with the long road to the Civil Rights Movement. As we celebrate and commemorate the Civil War, the Civil War 150, the 150 years in which the war began and ended, it is critical at this juncture in history that we commit ourselves to truth-telling and own up to our shared past. For indeed, we share the past. It is my distinct honor to have been invited to this historical marker dedication. I've been deeply moved by the commitment of the Georgia Historical Society in collaboration with the Georgia Battlefield Association and the Georgia Department of Economic Authority in recognizing and paying tribute to the histories and heritage of all Georgians as it relates to that historical moment that essentially defined America and what is possible in America. In an age of teardowns, rebuilding, and reconstruction, the erection of a historical marker serves as signposts that give us a sense of historical orientation, prospectively as well as retrospectively. No city can hope to understand its present or forecast its future if it fails to recognize the past. By tracing and preserving its past, a city like Atlanta can gain a clear sense of the process by which it achieved its present form. Many of our young people have this notion of pop-up history and frequently inquire, why do we even need to study the past? My answer to that question is usually, we study the past because it is still so present. It was the great American writer William Faulkner who wrote, "The past is never dead. In fact, it's not even past. Look around. Everything you see has a past. But whether historians have created a history around it is something entirely different. For history and the past are quite different. The past is present in everything. The past is present in language. If you are a Southerner, I'm almost certain that cotton picking is a part of your regional lexicon. It is usually spoken in opposition to something that we don't want to do. Imagine how the slaves felt. Artist Henry Ossawatt Tanner incorporated the past into the famed painting, The Banjo Lesson. The past is evident in architecture, monuments. Just look right across the street at our state capitol and you'll see all of the Confederate monuments that dot the grounds of our state capitol. And of course, it is evident in historical markers and street names. This marker dedication, The Burning and Destruction of Atlanta, acknowledges the historical significance of the Union Army's siege and capture of Atlanta. The Confederacy was determined to hold strong and steadfast to this jewel of the South with her precious transportation mechanisms that expanded across the state, eastward to Augusta and Savannah, northward to Chattanooga, southward to Macon, southwest to Columbus, and even west to Alabama and North Alabama. In 1864, Union forces followed the general route of the railroad southwards via Kennesaw and Marietta in order to attack Atlanta. The region now covered by metropolitan Atlanta became the target of several major army battles known as the Atlanta Campaign, including the Battle of Kennesaw, the Battle of Jonesboro, the Battle of Peachtree Creek, Ezra Church, Eutoy Springs, and the Battle of Atlanta. That Sherman was steadily advancing toward the city could not be doubted or concealed, but when admitted, was admitted with inexpressible regret. It had become evident to the Southern people that his policy was to destroy them effectually. He had left a dreary waste in his rear and threatened devastation in his front. September 4th, 1864, Sherman issued his order of exile, Special Field Order Number 67. The following details the proposed removal of the citizens of Atlanta from their houses. It was suggested to General Hood by General Sherman in the following communication. General Hood, commander of the Confederate Army. General, I have deemed it to be for the interest of the United States that the citizens now residing in Atlanta shall be removed. If you consent, I will undertake to remove all the families who prefer to go south with all their movable effects, clothing, trunks, reasonable furniture, bedding, etc., with their servants, white or black. No force will be used toward the blacks in one way or another. But if they want to go with their masters, mind you, the Emancipation Proclamation had already been issued, if they want to go with their masters and mistresses, they may go. Otherwise, they will be sent away. A report by General W.P. Howard to Governor Joseph E. Brown on the appearance and condition of Atlanta when left by the Federal Army, the following description was taken. Every species of mechanics that was not destroyed by fire was taken was most ingeniously broken and thus made worthless. And all of the steam boilers, switches, frogs, etc., nothing escaped. In the angle of Hunter Street, the street on which we stand, commencing to the City Hall and running east, and on McDonough Street, running south, all houses were destroyed. The jail and the calaboose were burned. All business houses, except on Alabama Street, commencing with the City Hotel, running east to Lloyd Street, were burned. So what was left? There was the Masonic Hall. There was our City Hall, Second Baptist Church, Second Presbyterian Church, Trinity Methodist Episcopal Church, and Catholic churches, and all the residences adjacent between Mitchell and Peter Streets running southeast and between Lloyd and Washington Streets running southwest, they were set. All the hotels except Gate City Hotel were burned. The estimate was that of 3,000 houses, only 400 were left standing within the city limits. And when those outside of the corporate city limits of the city were taken into account, it was estimated that Federal Army destroyed in and about Atlanta about 4,500 houses. Keep in mind that the Emancipation Proclamation had already been issued 1 year prior, January 1st, 1863. When President Lincoln announced that he would issue a formal emancipation of all slaves in any state of the Confederate States of America that did not return to Union control by that date, January 1st, imagine the anticipation that filled the hearts of every slave and free person of color. What a hopeful promise of what America could become. It would also do well for us to keep in mind the cause of the Civil War. It does not matter what ideology you subscribe to, the fundamental basis and cause of the Civil War was indeed slavery. The term slavery appears to have lost some of its steam due to our sanitization of the lived experiences of more than 4 million people enslaved in the Deep South. It must be understood that slavery is more than just a noun, but that slavery was an all-encompassing, malevolent, and venomous institution where the general lived experiences of human beings were defined day in and day out by constant fear at the hands of other human beings. As a demonstration, this is what slaves had to live with. This is what it means to be enslaved. This cotton is one of the crops that slaves were forced to provide labor for. This makes history visual, and I really want you all to take an opportunity to actually touch this. Slavery is inseparably linked to all of the factors that led to the Civil War, including states' rights, the preservation of the Union, and the economy. Martin Luther King Drive was initially Hunter Street, a street named for plantation owner Austin Hunter. As you move further out of the city center, Martin Luther King was once Mosley Drive, and it was named for a Confederate soldier. As you move even further out, the last leg of what we know today as Martin Luther King Drive, it was once Gordon Road, named for the famed Confederate General John B. Gordon. This marker dedication is most appropriate for this site because it offers authenticity of setting and context. This is the location of the burning of Atlanta, and this is a place to have it, and to place it elsewhere would be akin to heresy. I am reminded of what John Henry Clark, the African scholar, African world historian and scholar, stated. History is a clock that people use to tell their political and cultural time of day. It is also a compass that people use to find themselves on the map of human geography. History tells a people where they have been and what they have been. Where they are and what they are. Most importantly, history tells a people where they still must go and what they still must do. Today, April 11th, 2011, what must we still do? Where must we still go? We must build schools that educate and prepare our students, our citizens, to live in a global context. The community is no longer as it was, but we live in a global community where information is instantly accessible. I always end talks with an ancient Jewish proverb that says, to forget is exile, to remember is redemption. Acknowledging our history in this way is redemption. Thank you.
Hermina, thank you so much. That was very inspirational, very moving, and I appreciate so much you helping us to understand what happened on this site and why it is so important.